To hell with being a saint. I'm a doctor. The beginning of medicine. Chapter 6. Sane's expression as she observed him was far from ordinary. A thesis that had been a topic of discussion in the academic society for over 200 years had just been shattered, and it was accomplished by a young child who had just turned one. She didn't understand how he achieved it, but if magic could be cast with a flow of mana that she couldn't sense, then even the sorcerer of a higher circle than her could be attacked. It was a secret technique, or rather, a mysterious technique that everyone feared and revered. Therefore, Sane couldn't casually disclose this fact, because it was a fact that could incite a storm in the kingdom. Regardless of whether Ray was aware of this reality or not, he simply clapped his hands with a bright smile.
Wow, it worked!
Sane's expression grew even more complex as she observed Ray. She couldn't determine whether she should be purely happy or sad about this.
Thinking of it as atoms makes it easier to understand. And once the particles start to form a composite with mana, the shape is maintained even without injecting mana, right? How long will it last?
He had been tirelessly researching, even in the modern world. That habit didn't vanish just because the world he lived in had changed. Sayin sighed as she watched Ray muttering words she didn't comprehend.
My son being too brilliant is not necessarily a good thing. What should I do with my son? If he attracts the attention of the academic society, a bloody battle will ensue. What should my son do being caught in the middle?
Her concerns were not exaggerated. In fact, they were underestimated in some aspects. If Ray's unique method of mana manipulation was revealed, the kingdom and the academic society would acquire immense power. Ray himself was fully aware of this fact. Since the power of the country and organizations had increased, a war would inevitably follow. There is no nation that doesn't engage in war if it possesses excessive power. The term world peace had always been a weapon and justification for powerful countries and the sole shield for weaker ones. Thus, Ray had to conceal his unique method of mana operation, a blend of his mana and atomic theory, or in other words, his mana road. Naturally, it would have been preferable to keep it from his mother if possible. However, the reason he revealed it to his mother without any concealment was simple.
I don't know how long I can keep it a secret, but if it gets exposed, it's better to reveal it myself.
Ray asked as if he was oblivious.
Mom, is something wrong? No. I was just a bit surprised that you're already using magic.
As expected, Sane didn't disclose everything to him. Ray gave a slight nod. No matter how intelligent he was only 3 years old. It wasn't the age to discuss kingdoms, sorcerers, and academic societies. Parents wouldn't want to involve their children in matters that smelled of blood. Aware of this, he smiled and said,
I guess I'm a genius.
Indeed, he was a foolish genius. That night, he overheard his parents conversing. They waited until he was asleep to have a discussion, which seemed to be confidential.
What should we do? He'll be pulled into the academic society at such a young age.
Well, that's only if the academic society finds out. We just need to stay silent, right?
But the academic society is so ruthless. I, as a magician, know that all too well. If he catches their attention, even once, there will be no stopping what comes next.
Then we'll just have to flee. I don't want my child to go there and have his blood drained.
What do you mean, have his blood drained? Do you think the academic society is a nest of vampires?
That's not what I meant. Ignoring Ale's flustered voice, Ray closed his eyes.
They're discussing the possibility of being dragged into the academic society.
He sighed deeply and opened his eyes.
Then the most necessary thing is strength.
The moment of resolution arrived swiftly. The magic he had acquired through research became a source of power. He focused on magic, conducting various studies and experiments, and his understanding of mana increased rapidly. Then, he turned 15. There was a noticeable change in his appearance. His blonde hair began to show white strands and soon started to turn completely white from the age of 15. His parents were initially perplexed by this phenomenon, but they were soon reassured when they saw that he exhibited no particular abnormalities. The reason his hair turned white was due to mana. After removing all impurities and waste, mana also eliminated unnecessary elements in his hair. The reason color exists in hair is partly because during evolution, color was used to block sunlight, and it also served as a protective color for ancient humans. Back then, when there was a lot of dirt and trees, the adopted protective color was one that could effectively hide the body. Ray's hair began turning white from the age of 15. That's because mana deemed it as unnecessary. The protective color had evolved for survival in nature, but now that he had gained strength, the protective color was just an unnecessary element. At first, he suspected the absence of melanin pigment, but since the color of his eyes didn't change, it seemed not to be the case he was concerned about. If melanin was absent, his skin would have turned black due to the inability to block ultraviolet rays. Ray stretched out extensively. "Shall I go outside for a bit? I haven't been outside in the past year." He hadn't gone outside because he was focused on researching magic. Magic was fascinating, and he needed strength, so there was no time to waste. And there was something he needed to verify outside. "I have to see how much of the medicine I've learned so far applies here." From what he observed with mana, the physical structure of this other world was not different from the modern world, but nothing could be exactly the same. Since he couldn't experiment on his own body, he had to venture outside to gather information. Ray picked up a large wooden board and headed out. Once outside, the refreshing wind he had experienced before came rushing back. "It's truly an unbelievable tale. I, who used to live in the operating room, and now existing in another world." He held no regrets. He had spent his last moments saving lives in line with his beliefs, and he was content with his current life. It was a world where even a simple walk outside could be thrilling. If the air had a taste, would it be like this? He felt happier with each breath he took. The gleaming sunlight merged with the grass leaves, creating a vibrant green hue that enveloped the area. This is why I venture outside. Maybe I should visit the village today." Ray's house was situated a distance away from the village. Judging by the noise from the village, it didn't seem too far away, but it was closer to the forest than the village. He strolled leisurely, observing various flowers and resting on the grass. There wasn't a clear boundary line that marked the village. There were just houses and fences that gradually formed the village. It was quite a large village, even boasting a square. It's a bit large. This should suffice." He generated a small heat in his hand and began to write on the wooden board he had brought. Swoosh, swoosh, swoosh. The finished writing read as follows. "I'll treat the sick people. Anyone with a sick person, bring them here. If you can't bring them, I'll come to them." Most people laughed and walked past as he shouted loudly, waving his hand. "Anyone with a sick person, bring them here. If you can't bring them, I'll come to them." Most people laughed and walked past as he shouted loudly, waving his hand. "Treat sick people? You look like you're barely 15 years old." "If you want to play priest, do it at home, kid." "It's not right to joke about sick people. But you did write the sign beautifully." Little did they know, they were making a colossal mistake. The boy they had laughed at and passed by was in fact a modern-day god of medicine, a doctor that could even resurrect the dead. As time went by, he grew bored. "Are there no patients here? Why isn't anyone coming?" He never conceded that it was due to his untrustworthy age. Eventually, he started to take down his signboard, preparing to return home when a small child peeked around the corner. Only their face was visible from the alley, but it seemed they had business with him. Since he had no other plans if he wasn't busy, Ray collected his signboard and walked towards the child. Although he referred to them as a child, they appeared to be around his age. The child had striking red hair and was a cute little girl. Interestingly, her eye color matched her hair. Ray approached the cute child and asked, "Kid, do you have something to say to me?"
"Kid? What's your name?"
Perhaps because a child called another child a child, the girl pouted and replied,
"Elysia. Elysia von Gade."
Ray regretted asking as soon as she responded. Having a family name meant she was a noble. He didn't know her title, but considering the size of the village, she was at least a baronet. Speaking informally to a noble's daughter could lead to trouble. He slightly bowed his head.
"Nice to meet you. My name is Ray. I apologize for my rudeness, not knowing you were a noble young lady. Please forgive me."
Elysia's eyes narrowed at his sudden change of attitude.
"A kid called me a kid. And you're a kid too. Plus, you're a commoner."
That's not wrong, but... Being born a commoner is not wrong. It's just proof of one's social status, not a crime, as long as one doesn't commit any. Ray said this as a gentle reprimand to prevent the child. From being too absorbed in noble ideals. Of course, if this led to any annoyance, he was ready to bear it. He had the strength to do so. Elysia paused for a moment, then gently lifted the hem of her small dress and gave a slight bow.
"I misspoke. I apologize. I retract my statement."
Ray's jaw fell open. Of all the children he had encountered in his life, she was the most courteous and dignified in her actions. Seeing her display such politeness, he knew he should reciprocate. Ray slightly bowed his head.
"I have the impression you've been observing me for some time. Is there something you require?"
Elysia appeared to hesitate for a moment, but soon shook her head.
"No, this isn't a problem children like us can resolve."
The fleeting sorrow in her eyes and more profound sigh made her appear even more pitiful. It's preferable to voice a problem and attempt to solve it rather than remain silent and not try at all.
"Is that so?"
Elysia smiled faintly and then revealed the reason for her concern. Listening to her tale, Ray felt both astonished and puzzled. "So you're saying that someone you know is ill and there's no cure?"
"Yes."
Ray took a moment to ponder. Even though they were on the outskirts, considering the influence of the noble family, it might be a bit of a stretch, but he conceived a potential solution.
"But isn't there a holy maiden in the kingdom at present? Why don't you seek her assistance?"
At Ray's suggestion, Elysia's face looked as if she was on the verge of bursting into tears.
"The holy maiden is still a child. She can't go around healing people. Even the Grand Chamberlain couldn't cure the illness, so it's slightly incurable. I overheard this."
May I inquire about the symptoms they're experiencing?"
"I don't know much. Their skin turns red and inflates like a balloon."
Ray felt like something connected, but he wasn't entirely certain, so he shook his head. "Based on the description, it sounds like a malignant tumor. It would be more beneficial to examine the patient directly." Ray cautiously broached the topic.
"May I examine him?" "What? They likely won't approve."
Indeed, the idea was ludicrous. Bringing a common boy who played at being a priest on the streets to possibly treat a noble. Even he found the notion preposterous. Yet, he might be capable of healing them. He might be able to restore the smile to the worried girl's face, drawing from his past life's experience as a doctor.
"I might be able to heal them. Please, take me to them."
Touched by Ray's earnest plea, Elysia bowed her head in contemplation. The name of Viscount Gade was too significant a responsibility to entrust to a child she had just encountered on the streets. However, the boy's eyes, pleading for her trust and claiming he might be able to cure the illness seemed sincere to her. It could be a false hope or a deception, but she couldn't bear to watch her father's suffering any longer. She seemed to have reached a decision as she raised her head.
"All right, let's go together.
We must hurry if the illness is severe."
"Yes."
Chapter 7. Elysia seemed frightened by Ray's words, and despite wearing a dress, she began to run.
"Did you come out alone?"
"Ah, I slipped away from the guards. They would have surely objected."
Ray nodded his head, even as he ran. If something happened to the daughter while the Viscount was ill, everything would be ruined. He considered all the possible illnesses and symptoms that could occur, and soon spotted a rather large mansion in the distance. As they approached the mansion, guards blocked their path.
"It's me! Open the gate!"
"Elysia! And the boy with you!"
"Hurry!"
At her insistence, the guards reluctantly opened the gate. She sprinted through the garden after passing through the gate. Ray's expression was full of wonder. This was his first time seeing a noble's mansion. Vines that seemed to have been there for ages covered the outer walls, and dignified patterns were everywhere. If there was one drawback, it was that he didn't have time to admire the beautiful garden. There weren't many people who would decorate a garden so lavishly, even in modern times. The thought of walking in such a garden filled him with emotion.
"The payment will be just seeing this garden."
He had initially planned to charge for the treatment, but that thought was put aside. After passing through the garden, they reached the mansion's entrance, where a butler opened the door for them. "Welcome, Elysia."
"Where is my father?"
The butler did not answer Elysia's question. She became impatient at his lack of response. Without waiting for an answer, she rushed in, forgetting to guide Ray, and ran aimlessly. Ray closely followed her.
"Father!"
Elysia shouted as she opened the door. Ray was startled by her shout.
Was the sick person she knew Viscount Gade?
She saw the middle-aged man lying on the bed, unresponsive, and tears welled up in her eyes.
"Wake up! Gade! Viscount!"
She walked past those who were wailing beside the Viscount and took his hand. Seeing him not breathing, she felt as if she had been struck on the head with a hammer, realizing she could no longer converse with him.
"Ah, father!"
She called out to him with a glimmer of hope, but as expected, there was no response. Tears, like small beads, fell from her beautiful eyes. The tears that flowed down her fair cheeks eventually landed on Viscount Gade's hand. Now, she could only yearn for the person she had lost. She regretted not being with her father in his last moments. Why hadn't she been with her father in his last moments? What had made her resent the lump that had taken root in her father's chest? She clenched her teeth. Elysia turned around swiftly enough to make a whooshing sound and approached Ray. Her red hair slid smoothly over her shoulders and buried itself in Ray's embrace.
"Fix it! You said you can cure Dad!"
Elysia's muttering were heard by her mother, Chloe.
"What are you talking about? Fix?
He said he might be able to cure Dad."
Chloe quietly sobbed and thought,
"Fix? But he's already dead. How can—"
She wanted to argue immediately, but she held back her words because her daughter and the battalion commander were present. Elysia begged Ray,
"Please, save him."
But despite her tearful plea, Ray simply silently gazed at Viscount Gade.
"A tumor? The shape is strange. And is there a strange smell?"
Ray remembered smelling this before. It was the smell of the blood of a patient who was bitten by a poisonous snake when he went on a medical volunteer trip to Africa. As he examined Viscount Gade while resting his chin on his hand, Elysia caught his gaze.
Don't tell me. Can't you fix it?
Wait a moment.
You said you could fix it.
Ignoring Elysia's words, Ray spoke and attempted to channel mana through Viscount Gade's hand. Although weak, he felt the mana return to him. However, the mana gradually dispersed. Soon, all the remaining mana seemed to vanish. If his intuition was correct, this was both a tumor and a poison sac. Even though he didn't know what types of poison existed in this world, it was definitely poison. The skin had turned black and the flesh had decayed. Based on the Viscount's reaction, it wasn't a hereditary disease. Only poison could have such rapid effects in a short period. Since he hadn't encountered any chemicals in this world, he didn't consider biochemical weapons. Furthermore, the Viscount's mansion was not particularly unclean. In fact, it was quite tidy. Therefore, it wasn't a disease caused by poor living conditions or hygiene.
Is it poison?
Poison! Ray murmured softly, and the Patilian commander exclaimed in surprise. Who would dare to use poison in the Viscount's mansion?
Who dared to poison the Viscount's mansion?
Hold on. The poison might not have originated from inside, but from outside. While speaking, Ray surveyed the room. There was a piece of cloth soaked in water on the table. Gently wringing out the water, he wiped Viscount Gade's tumor with the cloth and something adhered to it. A yellowish pus-like substance clung to the cloth, and this time, he enveloped his finger with mana. The sharply pointed finger, now akin to a surgical scalpel, pricked the tumor. Then, pus oozed out. The fact that clumps of pus, rather than blood, flowed out indicated that many white blood cells had perished battling the poison in his body. Suddenly, a shriek erupted from the side.
What are you doing?
The piercing scream assaulted Ray's ears, and his expression naturally soured.
You told me to cure him. I'm determining the cause right now. Don't be absurd. How would you know that?
I know everything. Now, there was no trace of respect or courtesy in his tone. Of course, they could be shocked by a treatment they had never seen before. He understood that too. Anyone would panic when a 15-year-old kid started poking around in a wound to treat it. But this was already a hopeless case. In this desperate situation, they had no choice but to hope for a miracle. All they could do was trust the serious look in his eyes, which seemed different from the other doctors, and watch.
If you can't cure him, be prepared.
Have you entrusted your life to me? Ray grumbled and touched Viscount Gade's tumor with his finger again. The pus that oozed out with each touch was quite thick. Seeing how thickly it oozed out, it seemed to have been there for quite a while. Leaving it this long, it was no surprise the flesh was rotting. It was a tumor in name, but in reality, it was just a mixture of pus and poison in the pectoral flesh. He cut out the tumor lump with a scalpel. Those watching, including the commander, gasped, but they managed to endure it somehow. He set aside the removed tumor, then sliced open the chest. The ribs were exposed, and the lungs were slightly visible. Has the lung rotted too? How long has this been neglected? He couldn't understand why the priests and doctors hadn't cured him, but now that he had laid his hands on it, he had to cure it. Even if he was known as the Hand of God, he couldn't immediately transplant someone else's lung, and if the rotten part was large, it would be difficult to cure. Fortunately, the rotten part of the lung was not very large. Even if he cut it out, it would heal sufficiently through natural recovery. Ray didn't hesitate and carefully cut out the rotten part. His skill at cutting out only the useless part was almost miraculous. Even those who had looked at Ray as if he were a devil were now open-mouthed and lost for words at his handiwork. He moved his wrist flexibly, severing the dead nerves and reconnecting them. He transformed mana into threads, knotting and weaving them together. The commander stood there, completely stunned.
It's like crafting a doll.
To them, Ray's operation appeared like a proficient dollmaker creating a custom doll. Severing, reconnecting, weaving, knotting. But what was even more astonishing was the sense that somehow things were proceeding smoothly. It felt comforting as if he was merely toying with a corpse. Was it because he had removed their source of worry, the tumor? Or was it because, by meddling with the corpse, he had made Viscount's death seem more tangible? At least, it wasn't the latter. They couldn't articulate why, but standing in front of the young boy, they felt a sense of safety, even though he was only about 15. He was dependable. His charismatic demeanor seemed to discourage even conversing with him. But irrespective of their thoughts, Ray was engrossed in the operation. Since there were no medical instruments, he naturally had to invest his all into it. If there was a positive aspect, it was that he utilized mana instead of thread, which possessed a significant healing power. He concentrated all his nerves on Viscount Gade, who had been dead for approximately 5 minutes, and continued with the operation. He skillfully extracted the remaining pus from the tumor in the chest. In this alternate world, devoid of blood bags, he evenly dispersed mana throughout Viscount Gade's body to minimalize the bleeding as much as possible. If there was a somewhat challenging part, it was the suturing of the wound. Mana was used to generate a thread to stitch the wound, but his hands were not used to it. Being in a 15-year-old body, there was a sense of disconnection from the physical body he had during surgeries in the modern world, and his hands struggled to adapt. I should have practiced on animals before attempting actual surgery. He hadn't expected to undergo surgery so suddenly. Had he known this would occur, he would have practiced more beforehand. He chastised himself, but nothing changed. However, in modern times, earning the moniker Hand of God was not just a title. Adapting to it wasn't difficult. With adept hands, he applied the right pressure to the lungs while simultaneously sending electrical currents to the heart, which, although faintly, began to beat again. Thus, the heart was forcibly kept in motion. As the blood started to circulate, the major organs began to function. The previously dead cells started to work again, and the body began to produce what was necessary for movement. The once halted major organs began to function, and the body slightly twitched. There was blood seeping out in the process, but it wasn't significant bleeding. Now, it was time to restore the lungs' functionality and regenerate the slightly lost brain cells due to brain death. It would be acceptable to leave it as post-surgery rehabilitation treatment. Ray wiped the sweat off his forearm. His face was soaked with sweat from continuous concentration. Since there were no medical devices, he had to give his all in surgery. Phew! It seems like most of it is done. His mana, overwhelmingly purer than regular mana, wouldn't tolerate the intrusions of any foreign substances. Although not completely certain, the risk of secondary infection was virtually non-existent. Since the mana's binding strength was adjusted, there was no need to remove the stitches. The thread would dissolve on its own over time. Also, because the treatment was done with mana, a couple of months would be sufficient for recovery. Ray looked over Viscount Gade's body and tried flowing mana into him again. Although extremely weak, the heart was indeed beating. He had done everything he could. Since he didn't know the herbs of this world, he couldn't prescribe any medicines. Ray dusted off his hands and slumped down on the spot, while the captain hurried over to Viscount Gade. The captain appeared to be meticulously checking Viscount Gade's condition, as though verifying if he had indeed saved him as he claimed. Observing this, Ray believed that he might finally have a chance to rest. Just as Ray smiled contently and was about to close his eyes for a moment, the captain's shout rang in his ears.
You bastard!